This is why you should always watch videos to the end. In 2003, a woman came home to her apartment to see that her door was unlocked. She went inside, nothing was missing, so she assumed she must have left it open. When it happened a few more times, but still nothing was missing in her apartment, she went out and got a camera, set it up in her apartment, aimed at the front door. The next day, her door was unlocked, so she reviewed the footage. She watches in horror as late in the night, her front door opens and in walks this tall, creepy man who looks around and then walks towards her bedroom off camera. She immediately sprints out of her apartment and calls the police, who show up and tell her to go back in her apartment and just try to stay calm, and that they would put an officer right outside her door so she's safe. As she's sitting on the bed, totally traumatized, she realizes something. She only saw him enter her apartment on that video. She doesn't know if he actually left. As she's sitting there, she feels breathing on her ankles. She runs out, the cop comes in, and he finds the tall, creepy man under the bed holding a knife and a camera.
One day, I was in math class, and my crush was sitting next to me. We're gonna call him Diego. So, Diego and I were, like, teasing each other, we're, like, flirting, whatever. So fast forward 10 minutes, Diego asks the teacher, "Can I go to the bathroom?" And then Diego looks at me, and he's like, "I'll see you soon." And I was like, "Silly goose, what?" What? So Diego goes to the bathroom. Then I get a FaceTime call. Oh, this is the best pop. So I answered because I was like, okay, maybe something happened. Oh, something did happen, okay? So I answer, and the first thing I see is he's putting his camera on his, you know, his bacon down there. And you know what the best part is? So right when I answer, obviously I was scared, and I was like, oh. And then my teacher was like, "What happened?" She grabs my phone and looks, and she's like, "Why is it so small?"
My brother used to be obsessed with Call of Duty, COD 4. When he was like 12 years old, he had the headset and everything. And I don't know if you guys have ever heard someone play COD 4, but it kind of sounds like this. "Get him. Get that mother. Go. Go now. Yeah. You f***ing miss. You missed the f***ing guy. God." So it's a super wholesome game, but to annoy my brother, I used to sit next to him and watch him while he played. And one day he was playing with someone who had the username Little Pickle. And at the time, I was 10 years old and I really liked that username. I thought it was cute. So I changed all my usernames, AOL, email, Club Penguin, to Little Pickle. And then somehow my dad found out that I did that. And he thought Little Pickle was a really cute name too, so he started calling me that. And my brother, for some reason, didn't realize or didn't know. But my dad kept calling me Little Pickle for years, and then it caught on, so my friends started calling me Little Pickle. When I graduated college, my parents made a sign that said, "Congratulations, Little Pickle." Then one day last year, my brother was like, "It's weird that people call you Little Pickle." And I was like, "Why is it weird?" He was like, "I remember there used to be this super creepy kid on COD 4 who only ever talked about his penis, and he called it his Little Pickle. All he talked about was his dick." So now I'm 25, and people still call me Little Pickle. Meanwhile, there's some sketchy video gamer out there also calling his penis a Little Pickle, so.
This is part two of my scary childhood story about the door behind my dresser. Of course, my parents were really mad at us for opening it up, so they sealed it back up. They just didn't want us to get hurt from all the rusty nails or if there was mold inside. But I think we released something when we opened that door and a lot of things started to happen. First, I started having night terrors to the point where I would scream at the top of my lungs and not wake up. My parents would have to come downstairs and wake me up and put me back to bed. Then, every single night I would have this reoccurring dream that me, my mom, and my brother were all at a picnic at the beach. This super old lady would walk up to us and she would take me. She then would lock me up in the room behind my dresser. This dream would reoccur every single night for months. It scared me so much that I started to not sleep at night. I developed insomnia and would only sleep for 2 to 3 hours per night at only 8 years old. There was a couple nights where I swear I saw the old lady standing in the corner of my room. My parents just thought I was hallucinating from no sleep though. Stay tuned for part three.
This true story is so simple and so creepy. On June 21st, 2009, a 16-year-old wakes up to an empty house around 11 a.m. He heads downstairs, grabs a snack, and goes to the basement and plans on watching TV for the next few hours until he meets his friend around 3. About 30 minutes later, his mom comes downstairs and asks him, "Where have you been all day?" Confused, he says, "I've only been up for like 30 minutes. And then he looks at his phone, and it's after 7 o'clock at night. There's dozens of missed calls and several text messages from his friend and his mom asking, "Where are you?" He tells his mom that none of this makes any sense, but what she tells him is even worse. She said that she was there all day and saw him go into the basement at 11, but after that, he was gone all day. So for one day in the summer of 2009, this kid didn't exist.
So it's Friday night, it's Roxy's birthday weekend, and we're all going to her house for the first time ever for our group sleepover. So we get there, and honestly, everything seemed really normal at first. Roxy's house was really nice, and honestly, I was confused why she never wanted us there before. So then we start making banana bread, and all of a sudden, Laura jumps and screams and runs to the other side of the kitchen. She's like, "Did you guys feel that?" And we're all like, "What are you talking about, Laura?" She's like, "I swear something just touched my lower back." And Laura's face turned really pale, like she was genuinely scared. And we spend the next hour convincing her that no one was there, no one touched her back. So then we start watching a movie, Disturbia. Shout out to Shia LaBeouf. And Nina goes to the bathroom. And when she comes back, she's like, "Roxy, it looks like something upstairs is maybe leaking because there's this massive wet stain on your bathroom wall." And Roxy's like, "Oh, don't worry, that stain's always there." She's like, "We actually can't figure out where it's coming from. We've had plumbers come and they can't figure it out either. There's no drain or pipe or anything that could be causing a leak at that part of the house anyway." And then Roxy says, "But that's why we think our house is haunted." We all look at her kind of shocked, and she's like, "Yeah, that's why I never invited you guys to sleep over, because it can get kind of creepy." But honestly, at that point, I wasn't that creeped out until we went to bed, because that's when stuff started getting weird.
"This boy lied about his age just to date me. Story time. So back when my cute self was a senior in high school, there was this new girl that came to our school. Long story short, me and her ended up becoming super close. I went to her house, spent the night. Her family loved me. I mean, why wouldn't they? Anyways, she had a brother. We're gonna call him Binky. Me and Binky got pretty close. Now, I want you guys to keep in mind, Binky didn't go to my school because their parents were divorced. So the sister who I was friends with lived with her mom, and Binky lived with his dad who lived in another city. But sometimes Binky would go to his mom's house, which is how I met him. Now that we got that out of the way, as me and Binky were getting closer, one day he asked me, "Hey, how old are you?" And I was like, "Oh, I just turned 17. How about you?" He told me, "Oh, I'm 17 too, but my 18th birthday is coming up." After a while, me and him eventually started dating. Then one day, I ran into his cousin who happened to go to my school. The rest of this story is crazy.
This is why you should never play hide and seek. A mom decided to play hide and seek with her two kids. The mom began counting, "Ready or not, here I come." She begins searching the downstairs kitchen because she knows that they hide there every single time. As she's walking to the kitchen, she starts saying, "I wonder where they are." She looks under the table and sees they aren't there, which is kind of odd. She knew they were too scared to go into the basement alone, but she decided to check anyway. They weren't there either. She began to panic. The mom then says, "Jordan, Casey, come out now. Mommy's not playing anymore." There was no answer. Panic really begins to set in. She decides to call 911 and reaches an operator. She tells the operator what's wrong, and the operator sends an officer to her house. Once the officer arrives, he says, "Don't worry, we will find them." As she's sitting in the living room, she hears giggling and laughing and hears a closet door slam upstairs. She sprints upstairs and says, "Jordan, Casey, you worried me sick." She opened the closet door and nobody was there. While all of this is going on, she hears the doorbell ring. She runs downstairs and finds the officer holding Jordan and Casey. The officer says they were hiding in the shed out back. Then Jordan looks at mommy and says, "Why were you telling us to stay in the shed?"
This is my girlfriend is so embarrassing. It's not even funny. So last week we were grocery shopping and my girlfriend got caught stealing a can of plum tomatoes. Plum fucking tomatoes. So anyway, she got caught and now she had to go to court today. So I came with her. On the way to court, she's crying at me, this and that. And I feel for her. I mean, but she's really scared. So in the courtroom, the judge asks my girlfriend, he goes, "Excuse me, ma'am, I understand that you stole a can of plum tomatoes. Now, how many plum tomatoes were in that can?" So my girlfriend answers the judge. She says, 6, Your Honor. So the judge looks at her and goes, "I'm going to sentence you to one night in jail for every plum tomato that you stole." My girlfriend turns to me and starts bawling her eyes out. She's like, do something, please, please help me." So I look at the judge and say, "Your Honor, she also stole a can of peas last week too."
I am going to be telling you a scary childhood story. When I was 2 years old, my mom passed away. My dad wasn't in the picture, so I went to go live with my grandparents. My grandparents lived in a super old home that was built in the 1800s. I was a very imaginative child. So when I told my grandparents that I used to see people in the house, they just didn't believe me. There was one lady in particular that I would always see. She would sit at the end of my bed and watch me fall asleep. I wasn't scared of her because I thought she was an actual person. Plus, I was super little, so nothing even crossed my mind. At this point, I was like 4 or 5 years old. I remember her talking to me constantly. She even sang me the song "Rockabye Baby" to get me to go to bed one night. Every single day when I would get home, I could see her in my window. At that point, I thought she was just waiting for me. She just wanted to be my friend, right? But as I got older, things started to get really weird between me and her. She wasn't this nice lady anymore. Stay tuned for part two.
Have you ever met someone who wouldn't take no for an answer? That's what happened to Jillian. But things took a strange and unexpected turn. Jillian always went to this one cafe, and one day she bumped into a young man. His name was Charles. Charles came from a wealthy family and thought that no woman could ever say no to him. He asked Jillian to have coffee with him, and she did. They had a friendly conversation for a while, but by the time the cafe was about to close, Charles gently grabbed Jillian by the hand and asked her out. She said, "I'm sorry, you're just not my type," and left. This made Charles furious. From then on, he'd come to the same cafe every single day to hope that Jillian was there. It got to the point where Jillian would look through the window and see Charles waiting for her. She'd feel uncomfortable and leave. It just seemed like he wouldn't take no for an answer. But things were not so simple. One day, it was the final straw. Charles brought flowers to the cafe and waited for Jillian. When she didn't show up, Charles took the flowers, threw them on the ground, and stomped on them. He yelled, "That's it, I'm gonna make you my girlfriend if it's the last thing I do." The next day, he looked up Jillian's address in the phone book and went to her house. But he could never have expected what he would find there. Follow for part two.
I'm going to be telling you the scary story of the house I lived in elementary and middle school. It was a three-bedroom house, one bedroom in the basement, and two bedrooms upstairs. Because I was the oldest, I got put in the bedroom in the basement. Right when we moved in, I already had creepy feelings about the house. I hated being downstairs by myself. One day, I dropped a $20 bill behind my dresser. I decided to move my dresser all by myself, and behind the dresser was this door. It wasn't a normal door, it was really short and just squared. It was also glued off, so I couldn't get into it. Me and my neighbor, who were best friends, worked at it for days to get into it. We finally got it open, and inside was another room. It was almost like an underground attic. The walls were wooden, the ceiling was wooden, there was no carpet, but it smelled awful. My parents found out and they were super mad at me for opening the room. They of course put that dresser in front of that door for a reason because they knew I would explore it. But after that, things started to get weird.
So you put